Jai Gaura Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Hari Bol, Nitai Gaura Hari Bol, Nitai Gaura Hari Bol. Hari Gaur Premanande Hari Hari Bol Sri Krishna Balaram Ki Sri Gaur Nithai Ki Sri Srinivasa Govinda Ki Sri Prahlad Narasimha Dev Ki Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Can you display the verse? Is it possible to zoom it a little bit? Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. We'll be reading from Bhagavad Gita as it is, chapter 7, Knowledge of the Absolute, text 19. Please repeat. Bahunam janmanam ante gnanavan mam prapadyate vasudevah sarvam iti Sa Mahatma Sudurlabha. Anyone wants to repeat? Chant. Janmanam ante. Bahunam janmanam ante. Gnanavan mam prapadyate. Vasudevah sarvam iti sa mahatma sudurlabha. Okay, so let's go to translation and purport by His Divine After many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders unto me, knowing me to be the cause of all others and all things. Such a great soul is very rare. Please repeat. After many births and deaths, he who is actually in knowledge surrenders unto me, knowing me to be the cause of all causes and all that is. Such a great soul is very rare. The living entity, while executing devotional service or transcendental rituals after many, many births, may actually become situated in transcendental pure knowledge that the Supreme Personality of Godhead is the ultimate goal of spiritual realization. In the beginning of spiritual realization, while one wanting to give up one's attachment to materialism, there is some towards impersonalism. But when one is further advanced, he can understand that there are activities in the spiritual life and that these activities constitute devotional service. Realizing this, he becomes attached to the Supreme Personality of Godhead and surrenders to Him. At such a time, one can understand that Sri Krishna's mercy is everything, and that He is the cause of all causes, and that this material manifestation is not independent from Him. He realizes that material world to be a perverted reflection of spiritual variegatedness, and realizes that in everything there is a relationship with the Supreme Lord Krishna. Thus, he thinks of everything in relation to Vasudeva, or Sri Krishna. Such a universal vision of Vasudeva precipitates one's full surrender to the Supreme Lord Sri Krishna as the highest goal. Such surrendered great souls are very rare. This verse is very nicely explained in the third chapter of Shvetashvatara Upanishad. In this body, there are powers of speaking, of seeing, of hearing, of mental activities, etc. But these are not important if not related to the Supreme Lord. And because Vasudeva is all-pervading and everything is Vasudeva, the devotee surrenders in full knowledge. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjanasalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Namavum Vishnupadaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jai Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare Jai Srila Prabhupada. So very important verse in the 7th chapter. In the whole of Bhagavad Gita also, one of the important verses, this one. Bahunam janmanam ante gnanavan mam prapadyate Vasudevaha sarvam iti sa mahatma sudurlabhaha. So, here it is acknowledged that Bahunam janmanam, there is life after life. Usually in other theologies, life after life is not very easy to understand. It comes by default, naturally, for one who is born in Indian background. Bahunam janmanam. So, here is a definition of who can be a gnanavan. Gnanavan means, usually, one who possesses knowledge. Balavan means one who possesses bala. Gnanavan means one who possesses gnana. The real definition of gnanavan means, here it is given. Mam prapadyate. If one has to be called as truly gnanavan, a truly gnani, a truly knowledgeable person, what is the symptom? That this person, Gnanavan, Mam Prapadyate, he surrenders unto me. And that surrender is not very easy. Bahunam Janmanam Ante, it comes after many, many births, after trying to understand who we are. First of all, many people don't even try to understand who we are, isn't it? Among all the living entities that we find in this world, there are insects, worms, animals. The body of human species is very important, isn't it? Because only in human species we can inquire who am I, what is the purpose of life. And it is said that even amongst human species, there are so many uncultured species very close to animal species. They don't inquire who they are. They live like animals. And then there are those who inquire about who we are. They are considered to be the best amongst humans. And those who inquire who we are, they are the gnanis. Hardly one person becomes liberated. Meaning, he truly understands he is different from his body. Most of us think the body to be same as we. But this truly gnani comes to the realization that he is not this body. But to even surpass that understanding, and to understand that Krishna is the origin of everything from where we all came. He is the original father. He is the origin of everything. That is even more rare. That happens bahunam janmanam ante. After many, many births, a true jnani trying to understand who he is comes to the point of understanding Krishna as our original father and surrendering to Krishna. So Prabhupada says, our Acharya, if this kind of conclusion, or if a jnani takes so many births to come to this point of surrendering to Krishna, and you know it by reading Bhagavad Gita, why not surrender immediately to Krishna and save yourself from having to travel so many births? Because by our material senses, we cannot understand with our jnana, trying to understand the origin of everything, who we are, with our jnana. One time there was a rich man who is fond of fishing. And he had a friend who is a bhakta, devotee. This rich man is a jnani. He wants to understand everything by experiment, by objective understanding, by data, by rational logic, everything. So one time he put a bet to this devotee. He said, I'm going to this lake every day, and I bet that in this lake, the smallest size of the fish you can find is only 2 inches. You cannot find smaller fish than that. And this devotee, who is a friend of this rich man, says, no, you can find even smaller fish than that, less than 2 inches. And this rich man says, no, I cannot accept it, because so many days I have been catching the fish, and the smallest fish that is caught in this net is only 2 inches. Therefore, there cannot be any fish lesser than 2 inches in size. And so this devotee tries to disprove that. So what he does? So we have this strainer that we use in our kitchen to wash off the vegetables and fruits and all that. He gets a big strainer, goes to the middle of the lake and puts it in the water, deep in the water, and he comes out with fishes smaller than the 2 inches. And then he goes to this man and says, see, there are fishes smaller than 2 inches. Your knowledge is incomplete. And then he figures out why his knowledge was incomplete. And why? Because in that net that he used, the holes were of 2 inches in size. Isn't it? He can only catch a fish which is at least 2 inches or more in size. He cannot catch the fish beyond that or lesser than that size. So this jnanis, when they try to find out the root cause of everything, genuine jnanis, genuine seekers, they want to understand where we came from. They go back, and come to a point of Big Bang, from where everything originated, this universe originated, the planets, the stars, the life, everything originated from that point. And that they acknowledge that that point is not made of time, space, or matter. They agree that they cannot define that point. It is beyond their speculation or beyond their understanding. The only thing they say is that point is of infinite heat, infinite light, infinite energy, and without any dimensions. Because the moment you bring in dimension, there is space, there is mass, there is time, everything. But that point has to be without time, space, and matter, so they cannot define it. Because the senses we have is like the net of this fisherman. The conception of God and spirituality, it transcends the understanding of our material senses. Your senses need to be sharper. You need to purify your senses. Therefore, in the Upanishads, it is said, Atah Sri Krishna Namadi Na Bhaved Grahyam Indriyaihi. Sri Krishna Nama Adi. Sri Krishna means the Supreme Absolute Truth, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Sri Krishna. His name, his pastimes, his paraphernalia, his abode, Goloka Vrindavan. Na Bhaved Grahyam Indriyaihi. With your senses, you cannot capture. Because your senses have these holes. He goes through these holes. You cannot capture them. Na Bhaved Grahyam. But how is it possible? Sevon mukehi jifvadav swayameva spuratyadaha. Seva means devotional service. By seva, seva unmukha, by favorable devotional service, by what? Jihvadav. Jihva means tongue. What do we do with tongue? How? What seva we do with our tongue? Chanting, prasadam. Huh? So two important things. Chanting the holy name of the Lord, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And honoring Krishna Prasadam. Very, very simple things. Jihvadav, Sevon Mukehi Jihvadav, Swayameva Spuratyadaha. Krishna will reveal himself. He will make our senses qualified to understand who is God. So that kind of faith is not very easy. So the faith is required in everything. If you want to progress in life, you need to have faith. What to speak of getting the highest benefit of going back to Godhead, understanding who we are, what is the purpose of life. You need to have faith. And that faith is increased by the association of devotees. When you come and to temple and hear from devotees, that faith is increased. But if you associate with non-devotees, materialists, that faith will become lessened. Like, there was another time, this is another story. There was this man, atheist. He was trying to spread non-existence of God. And he said, God, if God existed and he would favor his devotees only, then how these other atheists, everyone is getting fed nicely. I am not praying God. I am enjoying life nicely. I am earning nicely. And I'll prove that God doesn't exist. And he stood there in the midst of these people and he said, if God existed, let him come and kill me in 5 minutes. I'm giving God a challenge. If he's really powerful, almighty, he should be able to do whatever he wants. I will not move. I will not use any weapon. Let him come and kill me in 5 minutes. And so the minutes are ticking away. And nobody knew what to say. And everyone is surprised what will happen. 5 minutes passed. And this person is beating his chest. See, I knew you're all blind believers in God. God doesn't exist. If he existed, if he was powerful, he could have easily killed me. So what to say to that person? So this one wise devotee came up and said, do you have children? Yes, I have one child. So if your child quarrels with you, say assume that your child quarreled with you and went away from your house. And he even forgot you and leading a separate life. And your child gets into an argument with somebody and stands amongst them and says, my dad doesn't exist. If he existed, let him come and kill me in 5 minutes. Will you go and kill your child? Said, no, he's after all my child. He might have forgotten me. Why would I kill my child? That exactly is the happening here. Everyone is a child of God. Sarva yoni shu kaunteya sambhavanti murtayaha. Tasam brahma mahatyo nir Aham Bija Pradahapita, Krishna says in 13th chapter. Every species, every living entity is my child. But unfortunately, we have forgotten that Krishna is our eternal father. And we are suffering in this world, just like this boy goes away from his rich father and struggles for maintaining his life. Our suffering is because of forgetfulness that Krishna is our eternal father. Every one of us is the loving child of Krishna. So that when you associate with devotees, the true conception of God comes out. Otherwise, it's just hodgepodge. Everyone understands, oh, God is nothing but it's a framework we created so that we can do some good deeds. There is nothing like God. Or you are God, I am God. No need to surrender to anyone. So all these kinds of things will come. So in an interview with Srila Prabhupada, our founder Acharya, so the interview, they called the title of that interview, they published that in a magazine, Back to Godhead magazine, that the magazine that we distribute in our movement. They called the title of that interview as Slave Mentality. They called it slave mentality because surrendering to somebody, becoming a slave of somebody. So you guys have a slave mentality. So this interviewer was asking some question. I wrote down some questions that this interviewer asked. So he started off saying, so Swamiji, Srila Prabhupada is asking, what is your understanding of God? So this interviewer is saying, to me, God is just freedom. That's what it means. Nothing beyond that. And then Prabhupada is answering, yes, God means freedom, provided you surrender to God. Provided you surrender to God. That is real freedom. The interviewer is saying, but I may not accept your idea of God. I may want to worship God or I may not want to worship God. That is my freedom. Why are you asking me to surrender to God? And that's most important to me, that freedom. So Prabhupada is saying, a child's freedom, for instance, is to live completely under the protection of his parents. Wonderful point, isn't it? The child's freedom, he can enjoy his life, he can enjoy his freedom, provided he takes shelter of his parents. Then he has freedom. But without their protection, he will have no freedom, only suffering. If the child is very rebellious, he may think he doesn't need his parents. He wants to be free, but he is just a rascal. He does not really know what freedom is. Similarly, if you don't surrender to God, then you are misusing your freedom and you will lose your freedom. The Bhagavad Gita says, Daivihi esha gunamayi mama maya duratyaya. So the point is, we are never free. A citizen may think he is free, but he is under the regulations of the government, isn't it? In that sense, he is free. Can you go and tell the government, I want to do whatever I want? There is nothing like freedom. The freedom exists under the conditions of surrender. Either you surrender to the government or you will be forced to surrender in the prison house. Then you lose the freedom. So the true freedom means surrendering to God. So then the interviewer is asking this question. But isn't that a rather stifling kind of slave mentality? Isn't that a slave mentality to become surrendered to God, surrendered to somebody? So Prabhupada is explaining here the same point. Either you become slave of Krishna, in your words, or you become slave of Maya. So this Alexander, the great king Alexander, one time he was winning all these kingdoms and he was going back to his country. And he remembered that his countrymen had asked him, if you are coming from India, from that side, we hear that in India there are great yogis and self-realized people who practice renunciation, who practice this process in forests. So we want to see them. Can you bring one of them? We want to hear their teachings. We cannot all travel to that place. We want to hear their teachings. We want to see what he acts, how he acts, how he goes about self-realization. Can you bring him? So this Alexander remembers that. So on the way back, he goes to the forest. And so he finds a yogi practicing meditation under a tree. And then he goes and waits patiently until he opens his eyes. He says, dear yogi, you need to come with me so I can take you to my great kingdom. I am this great Alexander. And I introduce you to my people and you need to instruct my people. And this yogi calmly says, no, I am happy where I am. It's simple living in the forest. That is not my goal. My goal is inwards. I am happy the way I am. So he declines politely. And Alexander becomes raged with anger. How dare you reject me? Don't you know I am the greatest king ever? How dare you? Alexander calls him, you are my slave, you need to come with me right now. So this yogi says, you are calling me your slave, but actuality is, you are the slave of my servant. You are the slave of my servant. And this enrages Alexander even more. How dare you call the slave of your servant? He takes his sword out and is about to kill him. And then the minister next to him, no, he is a wise man. You better ask him what he means. And then Alexander cools down and says, what do you mean, slave of your servant? The yogi says, yes, by my austerities, I have been able to control my anger, control attraction to sense objects. I have been able to win over my senses and mind. But you cannot control your anger. You are the servant, you are the slave of your anger. However your senses dictate you are acting. However your anger dictates you are acting. Therefore you are the slave of my servant. Anger is my servant. So a person engaged in self-realization and truly becomes conqueror of his senses, he is called Goswami or Swami. Means he's the master of his senses. If you actually try to analyze the problems of the world, it is because of trying to lord it over everything for my sense gratification. Isn't it? I want this, I want that. The lust is never satisfied. You're always hankering for more and more and more. So the true happiness can be obtained when one comes to conquer this lust, conquer the senses. Srimad Bhagavatam also instructs through many stories. Especially there is one story of King Yayati. So this Yayati was a great king. And one time he happens to see a woman caught in a well. The woman was the daughter of Shukracharya, Devayani. So she is caught in the well. And there is a story behind how she gets caught in that well. She and her friend Sarmishtha. Sarmishtha is the daughter of a king. And somehow there is a misunderstanding between them. And Sarmishtha becomes agitated. And she throws Devayani into the well and then off they go. And then this Yayati finds Devayani stuck in the well. And he rescues her. And obviously he gave her hand and she likes him and they want to get married. And his Devayani's father, Sukracharya, agrees for the marriage, even though he was a Kshatriya. Usually Brahmana women should marry somebody of the same caste or a higher caste, or Brahmana caste for in the Vedic background. But because of these unforeseen circumstances, they agree for the marriage. They get married. And Devayani goes and tells the story to Shukracharya, how this Sarmishtha threw her in the well and insulted her. And so Shukracharya is a powerful Brahmana priest. He's about to curse the king, the father of Sarmishtha. But the king comes and begs forgiveness and says, whatever you want, I will do. And then he says, Sarmishtha, Devayani wants Sarmishtha to be her maidservant. So Sarmishtha becomes maidservant of Devayani and goes to the place of Yayati as maidservant. And so Yayati enjoys with Devayani for a long time. But because Sarmishtha is also the maidservant of Devayani, Yayati also enjoys with Sarmishtha. That irks Devayani. So she complains again to Sukracharya. So Sukracharya curses Yayati to become an old man. He loses all the power of his youth and he becomes an old man. But he begs for forgiveness and Sukracharya says that if you exchange your old age with one of your sons, then you can take their young age. So one son agrees, all the sons they reject. Maharaj Puru, he agrees to take the old age of Yayati and gives him young age. And so after he regains the young age, again he starts engaging in sense gratification with his wife Devayani for years and years and years. And then in Srimad Bhagavatam it is written how in the end he becomes disgusted with that sense gratification. Even though he was a king, and in those days their level of sense power is much more than what we have. And even though he was able to enjoy with Devayani for so many years, finally that renunciation sets about. And he becomes renounced and tells a story of their own story to Devayani. You know, there was once a goat, a male goat. It rescued the female goat in a well, and then they got married. And so he tells this story and then he says, now that male goat is renounced, he wants to go away from home. And then he explains how this material sense gratification, the lust, is like the more you pour, the more butter, the more fuel you pour to it, the more it increases. So here what Prabhupada is explaining, it is not a slave mentality. To become surrendered to God is actually becoming master of your senses. It is the other way around. If you don't surrender to God, you are becoming a slave of your senses. And then this interviewer, but throughout history, people have fought valiantly for the freedom to enjoy life to the fullest in the pursuit of happiness. So Prabhupada is saying, that means they are thinking that freedom means to become the servant of the senses. Freedom means to become the servant of the senses. But that is not real freedom. Real freedom means we are not disturbed by any agitation in the mind, disturbed by our sense gratification. That is real freedom. Vacho vegam manasa krodha vegam, jihva vegam udharopasta vegam, etan vegan yo vishaheta dhira sarvamapimam prithivim sa sishyat. One who can become freed from these forces of speech, vacho vegam, forces of mind, which is dragging us, all these forces are dragging us to behave in abnormal ways, to behave in sinful ways. And a person who can withstand vishaheta, that person is a dhira. So surrendering to Krishna is the best thing one can do. And that surrendering process starts with, as I said, jihvadav. Simply by chanting the holy name of the Lord. It cleanses our heart of all impurities. And it gives the power to withstand these urges of the senses and of the mind. So that mantra I'll repeat again. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. So if we can chant this mantra, the surrendering process starts by chanting this mantra. Because the holy name is not different from Krishna. The chanting is nothing but a child calling out a lost child, how pitifully he calls out for his lost mother. Have you seen, you might have seen in the temple sometimes, the child keeps running, crying, bitterly crying, looking for his mother. Isn't it? So this chanting is exactly like that. We should acknowledge that we are lost children of Krishna. And when we cry in the same way, Krishna reciprocates. And Krishna gives intelligence. Tesham satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. How one can go back to him? He gives intelligence. If you surrender to the holy name, so you're all being given these beads. So this mantra, Hare Krishna mantra, is non-different from Krishna. So if you chant nicely, all you have to do is pay close attention with your full consciousness and with a mood of our lost relation, with a mood of utter dependence on our eternal Father, asking him to take us back to him. So if we chant in this mood, Krishna reciprocates. But chant it outside your minds, pronounce each and every syllable very nicely and hear it very attentively with your ears. Then you can perceive the benefit. Can I get one beads also? Is anyone coming for the first time? Holding the beads for the first time? Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Welcome. So, can you give me one bead so I can teach people how to hold? So there is a thread on the beads, the white or orange thread. Just leave out the bead which has the thread. Go to the next one. And on each bead, we chant the complete mantra. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. And then we go to the next one. Again, chant the full mantra. And then go to the next one. So pull it towards you. So like that, we complete 108 when we reach the bead just before the thread bead. So as I said, chant outside, not within your mind. The sound vibration, Krishna enters your ears and enters your heart and cleanses your heart. So chant outside and concentrate on the syllables, each and every syllable. And the mood is important. Mood is that of surrender and humility, dependence on God. Any questions before we start? So let's take the blessings of Guru Gauranga before we start. Please repeat as I say. Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Iti Namine Namaste Sarasvate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvisesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jayasri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Sri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. So we'll chant together. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Rama Rama.